Very, very good. So now I think Carrie got children's time. The kids would like to come forward.
Good morning, girls. How are y'all? Good. All right. These are all Peyton's books. Okay, so we're going to put these books in this bag one at a time. Can you help us count how many there are? There's one, two, three, four, five, six. Oh my goodness. Seven. 8, 9, 10 books. Do you think that's going to be pretty heavy, or that's a piece of cake to lift? Pretty heavy? Probably. Tyson, he's been doing lots of push-ups lately. Do you think he can hold that book bag out for a little bit? Okay, let's watch him try. Okay, let's see how long he can do it. He's got to hold it straight out. One handle on each hand. There you go. All right. Let's count and see how long he can last. Let's see. One, two, three, four, five, six. Oh, his arms are shaking. 9, 10. Man, his arms tired out and got heavy, and it was hard, wasn't it? Well, these books, they're kind of like sins or troubles or worries that we might have, right? And although we don't have sins in this bag, but we might have sins in our heart, or we might have worries or trouble. What are some things that we might be worried about, or some things that maybe we shouldn't do? Got any ideas? Right, so we should be nice to our siblings. Are you ever not nice maybe to your sibling? Do you worry about stuff at school maybe? Does homework get you down? Sometimes the wind every day, all day long, makes me unhappy, right? So sometimes we want to just get a bigger book and cover all those up so we don't have to see them, right? Should we do that? It's only going to make it heavier, right? We need somebody to give our sins and our worries to, right? Who do you think that might be? Jesus, yeah.
I'm glad that was Tyson doing that, not us. Let's stand up and sing. We have such a friend in Jesus.
To God in prayer. Father, thank you so much for your many blessings. We put our thankfulness, we put our burdens all on the feet of the cross. Thank you for all what you do. Thank you for the opportunity to give you back some of what you have already given us. And we ask you to bless those who manage it and make it good for your kingdom. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen.
Anytime I don't know
I guess by now some of you has figured out where this message is going today. That was an excellent children's message there about the load. And so many of us carry such a load through our lives. We carry family things, we carry financial things, we carry work things, and we carry a lot of stuff that we don't have to. And it's stuff. And at the end of the day, we don't remember it normally. I had an old boss years back that he come in one morning and threw a National Geographic down on the table in front of us. And he said, look at this picture, Tom. And I was looking at it, and it had a bunch of these little old bitty old guys, and they all had big heavy baskets of rocks on their head. And I think it may have been in Guatemala, actually, was where it was taken. And it said the longevity of those people, they lived to be, you know, well to 100 for most of them. And he looked at me and he said, you know, if I have to carry a load like that, though, I don't think I want to live to be 100. So here we have the opportunity today to look at some of the things that we carry, some of the things we don't need to, and the fact that time is very short. So the title of this message today is Time is Very Short. Billy Graham lived a short life that men would say was a long life. He was born November 7th, 1918, and died February 21, 2018 at the age of 99. Billy accepted Christ as his Savior around the age of 16. He spent his life serving God. His Bible was a red-lettered King James Version, and Billy was dubbed as America's pastor. He met and prayed with several U.S. presidents and other world leaders. Billy Graham preached the gospel and remained humble throughout his life. Now, I would like for you to watch this short video of Billy Graham here at this time. Thank you.
Time is short. What is your life? It's even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. If someone had told me when I was 20 years old that life was very short and would pass just like that, I wouldn't have believed it. And if I tell you that, you don't believe it either. I cannot get young people to understand how brief life is, how quickly it passes. It seems like yesterday I was in school. Every one of us here has been given the same amount of time in a day. 1,440 minutes a day, 168 hours per week. 70 years God allows us. And it's interesting to me, with all of our medical science, we've never passed that magic mark. The average American male today lives 70 years and 4 months. The average female, 73 years and 6 months. More people live to be 70, but the average age of an American is still 70, as taught in the scriptures. What a thing it is when you think that you have just one short life to spend, and it'll soon be over. I'd write down my priorities in life, and I'd get committed to certain priorities. Now is the accepted time, the things we ought to do, the classes we ought to take, the books we ought to read. Do it now. The family that needs you, spend more time now. Write that letter home now that you've been meaning to write. Money you ought to give now. Time for study, do it now. People you ought to witness to, do it now. Every time the clock ticks, it seems to say now. Today, if you will hear his voice. There may not be a tomorrow for you and for me, because there's a warning to time. Time is running out for all of us. Time is too short for indecision and vacillation. Do not halt between two opinions. Fools say that time is long. Every morning we have 86,400 seconds to spend and to invest. And each day the bank named time opens a new account. It allows no balances and no overdrafts. If you fail to use the day's deposits, the loss is yours. The Bible says, redeem the time because the days are evil. and the days in which we're living are very evil. If there was ever a time for the gospel that can transform the human heart, it's now. Jesus said, as long as it is day, we must do the work of him that sent us. The night is coming when no man can work. The night is going to come in your life. Yet there was a serenity about the work of the Lord Jesus. It's the quality of life, not the length. Jesus only had 33 years, and it ended on the cross. To the world, he was a failure at that moment. Yet at the end of his life, he said, I finished the work that thou gavest me to do. It doesn't matter whether you live another year or 2 years or 5 years. Will your work be finished? Is there a quality to it? Is there a dedication to it? Suppose all of our members tithe their time to witness for Christ as we tithe our income for the church. Fill your heart with the Word of God. I've found that those who know the Scriptures are the ones that have the power today. But we need men and women who walk with God. And if you do that, you too can finish the work that God gave you to do. And help us to realize the brevity and the urgency of time. And may we invest what little time we have in the kingdom of God.
So you see, that man that lived 99 years knew time was short, that it would pass him. And he understood that. Most of us, if you look around, there's a lot of older people in the church, and most of us are 70 or above, a lot of us. And that, to me, is a fulfillment of God's promise also to give us long lives if we follow him. So we see young people dying all over the country with fentanyl, suicide, all kinds of other things, because they have heavy burdens. They have a load that they're trying to carry. So as we go into the message this morning, I want to open us with prayer again, that God would open our hearts and our minds to receive exactly what he intends us to receive today and nothing else, that we would not be offended by his word or by anybody around us or anything that looks upon us or that we look at, but we would have our eyes cast upon Jesus Christ and him alone. So join me as we pray. Father God, I thank you so much for this time. I thank you for the life that you gave Billy Graham, that he was able to, you know, preach your gospel for years and years and see many, many people come to the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And Father, I pray that today, that every word said here today, every thought would be upon you and about you to bring you glory, and that we might know the purpose that you have for each one of us to do your work in the precious and mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So now if you'd turn back in your Bibles to Matthew 11, we'll look at those two verses that Carrie read. You know, I have to get everything three or four times. I don't know about y'all, but and this is in red letters, by the way, too, in most Bibles. I was going to show you. I ordered a new Bible in preparation for today, and it came Friday. So I got the honor of carrying it today, at least, you know. So Jesus said there, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my load is light. You know, we saw how long Tyson was holding that up here in the children's sermon, didn't we, this morning? And that wasn't that heavy of a load, was it? But even then, he could only hold it for so long. People fail to lay down these loads at Jesus' feet, to take it to him with anything that they're troubled about or carried about. A few years ago, I watched a sermon with the Potter's House where he come out on stage, and this guy is very theatrical, and he come walking out on stage with a bunch of baggage and a bunch of luggage, and he started throwing it off as he was showing how to get rid of baggage out of your life. And I thought that was such a good sermon for me because it made me realize of some of the things that I'd carried for 50, 60 years, you know, that I hadn't laid at God's feet. So then that's one thing I want you to think about this morning. If there's someone that you haven't forgiven, that's a heavy burden. If there's some load you're carrying, think about how to leave that here today, actually. These words that's in red letters there, Jesus is speaking to us right now. These words require a response from anyone who hears them. We have the opportunity to accept or reject His offer at any time. Some of the simple facts of the path to our salvation are all of sin, that's in Romans 3:23. The penalty for our sin is death, Romans 6:23. Jesus died to pay the penalty for our sins, 1 John 1:9. And Jesus is coming back again. And that's all over the Bible. The Bible from Genesis to Revelation is only about Jesus. People try to make it about other things, about things that the Pharisees want to do, the things that the world wants to do. But the simple fact is, it's all about Jesus and nothing else. Billy Graham once said that the end will return. The end will come when Jesus Christ returns. That is why a Christian can smile today in the midst of all this stuff that's happening, because we know the end of the story. Okay? What about somebody? Does anybody know anyone in town that's downtrodden and you know, just upset all the time about everything? Do they have any assurance of what their end is? Absolutely none. Absolutely none. But I'm going to tell you something that kind of convicts all of us. It's our job to tell them about the end. It's our job to tell them about Jesus. It's our job to tell them about where they can lay those heavy burdens down. That's our job. That's why Jesus came to give us the gospel, because He said, what? Go ye therefore. Okay? And some of us can't go, but we help other people go, don't we? You know, this church here, the Baptist church here, has been helping people go share the gospel for my entire life. You know, and it's proven over and over again what a benefit that is to people that don't know Jesus. You know, and so as we help these different organizations, missionaries, to go forth, as we give money to different things to raise children up at the children's home, as we do these things, we're a part of going and preaching the gospel. It's an important part. Just like the guy that goes and preaches and is a missionary, he can't go unless he has a whole support field. And see, one of the thoughts when you're fixing to preach anywhere as a guest preacher or deliver a sermon is that no one will show up. So then when you come into a place and people showed up, it's encouraging. You know, it really is. But see, the people that show up even, aren't they supporting the gospel of Jesus Christ? Because they're encouraging people to continue to go forward. In our society today, we have pastors retiring and quitting all over the place. You know, to name a few, Melrose, Tooten, Cary, Highlands Baptist in Clovis. My old church in El Paso, Hondo Valley Baptist, you know, and at one time was a huge church and maybe have 40 people there a week now. You know, and all these places are looking for pastors. Okay, it takes those people there at those places to support pastors to do what they did, to be able to preach the gospel, to be able to serve the Lord. Some of us are blessed. The Lord has given us our living. We don't need a living. And so we're able to go places and preach the gospel or teach whatever God's calling us to do. Maybe that's your calling. And you haven't answered it. I don't know. Maybe your calling is to go someplace for the Lord. You know, I don't like to travel anymore, so I don't like going very far. So what about you? In John 3:16, God gives us his promise, whoever believes that Jesus is our Savior will have everlasting life. We either believe that or we don't we? And it's written in red letters also, so Jesus said it. But by not making a decision to follow Christ, you've made a decision. I did a sermon a couple of years ago now at Hagerman, New Mexico, as a guest. And the title of it basically was Barbed Wire Fence. If anybody can walk on a barbed wire fence through their life, I'd like to see them. Not making a decision of falling one way or the other. You know? And especially if you go out to some of these out here outside of our town that they go like this. You know? And then you step on it and it goes to the ground so you can step across it. Pretty hard to walk on. But that's what so many people in our country and in the world are doing today. And they don't realize what they're doing. They're trying to walk on this fence. They want to be in the world and they want to have Jesus. And you can't do both. When you're in the world, if you're not professing Jesus, if you're not praying continuously, if you're not going to him with everything, you're in the world. Because what will get our attention? The world. The world. I love television. I've told all of y'all that before. I love television. I get me a Western movie going. Like yesterday they had Kurt Douglas on and all those guys, you know, and it's hard not to watch it. I'm like, I want to watch that, Lord. I don't want to study your word. I don't want to prepare, you know. And then, well, you know, you got Sunday coming. Sunday's coming. Well, how about if I wait till the last minute and I get up early in the morning? Okay. Am I devoted to Jesus at that point? I'm taking care of myself. Same thing when I get in the recliner and I'm watching football or something again. It's all about me at that time. In men's study, we've had a thing going for a while, and here a couple of weeks ago we had the type of people, and I've been looking at people now and I'm telling myself this, so you know, I'm going to have to work out of it. Y'all pray for me. But there's two types of people, basically. There's the here I am and the there you are. Jesus was a there you are guy. Okay? I've been a here I am most of my life. You know? So which way are we going to go? Are we going to go like the Bible and do what God created us for? On Sunday night, we've been going through what our purpose is and studying the scripture with that and why we were made. You know, we were made to praise God and to work, take care of the garden. So unfortunately, we have weeds coming up in our garden, don't we? They're called people. You know, I had a little boy tell me a while back, he looked up at me and he says, you know, Tom, I don't like people. And I said, you know what? I don't think I do either, Ezra. And then we went on and he put on his hoodie and his cap. And then we went on and played and stuff and threw up a ball in the air and yelled and had a great time. And then the last time I saw him, which was like a year later, he's been going to Sunday school and church. And he looked up at me and he says, you know, Tom, I love people. See, the greatest commandment is what? Love God. What's the second? Love your neighbor. You know, and that's a hard one. You know, by not making a decision, we make a decision. I praise God that Jesus paid my debt that I couldn't pay. It wouldn't matter how many good works I did, how much money I gave to the church, how many trips I went on with youth, how many Sunday school lessons I taught, how many churches I went and subbed, how good I was to people, how much I helped people. None of that matters without Jesus. None of it matters. And people can't get that through their head. They go for business, they go for pleasure, they go for whatever. But if they're not making it about the Lord Jesus Christ, they're missing it. They're missing the boat. You know, the thing about it too, when Jesus paid the debt for my sins, it was a debt he didn't owe. Could you imagine somebody coming paying off your debts that you didn't know? I do it for other people, you know, mostly children. But I kind of doubt I'd go pay off somebody else's. But Jesus paid all of our debts for every one of us in here. So if someone pays something for us or does something for us, as good Americans, what do? We normally do? We have to pay them back, don't we? Tick for tack. We owe them something. But yet people have the attitude now that they don't owe God anything. He's out there, he's some good dad, some good father. You know, if I need him, I'll run to him when I'm sick or I need money. Job's not going right. Family's not going right. My friends are not going right. They're not doing what I want them to do. He's out there all the time and he's waiting for us. See, Jesus wants to be, and we need him to be, and to let him be, Lord of our minds, Lord of our bodies, and Lord of our hearts. That's three things, isn't it? What happens when you get three strikes at baseball? Okay? So three strikes. He wants to be, and we need him to be, Lord of our hearts, Lord of our minds, and Lord of our bodies. Whether you realize it or not, guess what? Your body don't belong to you. And if you're a Christian and you've been saved, it's not yours anymore. These things that we want to do, you know, I don't know about y'all, but I love going to Disneyland. Haven't been there in quite a few years, but that was one of my favorite things with the kids. I had more fun than they did. And I tell them, leave me alone. Y'all, here, go play. You know? So we have those things that we like to do, that we love to do. But do we put God first, you know? Do we put him first in all the things that we do? Ephesians 5, 15 and 16 gives us a warning to be careful because the days are evil. Okay, have your days been evil this week? I got soaked from a well on Wednesday during the wind and the storm from head to toe. You know, my computer didn't want to load. I had to stop and load my printer during the middle of this. And I get stressed easy. I don't know about y'all, but I get stressed easy. And then you're like, what do I do now, Lord? And then hopefully I'm going to ask him quick before I get into all this other stuff about kicking the pump or throwing the printer through the window, you know, and all those types of behaviors. How am I going to react? What is someone going to see me do? Because somebody's always watching. Somebody's always listening. You know, one of my friends told me a story about a preacher that was hammering a nail and hit his thumb. And he didn't say anything. And he was helping him do a roof. And when the preacher didn't say anything when he hit his thumb on the thing, the guy that was doing the roof only charged the church for the material. Didn't charge him labor. Because he said, he's the real thing. He's the real thing. People notice how we live. Just like if I had on my tie crooked this morning, which it probably is, all of you would notice it. And that's the thing we got to realize also, is that other people notice everything about us, about our conversation, our language, and our mannerisms. You know, you ever roll your eyes behind somebody when they say something? Okay. What happens if that person sees you? You know, I had a young man that worked with us at Berlin, and I was kind of on one of the guys one night there, and it was late, and he was the safety officer, and so he was involved. So he got behind the guy, and I'm trying to be serious, and this guy went like this. Crybaby loser, right? And so how do you maintain when somebody is doing something like that? You know? So our actions and our movements and our words matter. John 14:6 instructs us that no one comes to the Father except through Jesus. He is the only way to heaven. Not being good, not being moral, not being rich, not being the best friend of everybody in Fort Sumner, not being anything won't get you there. You know, these people are getting into this coexist. Y'all have seen that, right? Where all good people's going to heaven. God is so good. He loves us so much. He's not going to send anyone to hell. You know, look how good those people are. You can think of some groups. How good those people are. God ain't going to send them to heaven, to hell. He's not going to let that happen. No, he's not, because they're choosing it. By not making a choice, they're making a choice. By trying to be good in works. He's the only way. Nothing else will get you to heaven. Jesus is enough. And he is more than enough for everything that we could look for in him. Everything we could hope for. He is more than enough. I often say when I'm getting wet or hit my thumb or break something and trying to put it back together, I often say, where does my help come from? Okay, help me, Lord, so I don't lose it right here. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord. You guys know what I'm talking about that has these places and pickups with mesquite flats and everything else going on. It's kind of hard to keep your composure sometimes. You get the old jack out and it's high lift in sand and it falls three or four times while you're trying to change a tire. It's kind of hard to keep your patience. Ladies, the same thing. You know, you've had enough of the kids, you know, and you say, I've just had enough. You need to go somewhere. Go to your room. Stick your nose in the corner. Do something, but get out of here before I have to hurt you. And our actions and our behavior affects everybody around us. And we seldom actually realize that, of how much damage by how we act we can be doing to our own family, our friends, or somebody that cares about us. And simple words of saying words that are hurtful. And who wants us to do that? The enemy. He don't want us strong in Jesus. He don't want us coming to church. He don't want us learning the Word. He don't want us studying the Bible. And he's going to do everything he can to knock us off the straight and narrow. And most of us go like this anyway, don't we? But he's trying to knock us off the straight and narrow. Psalms 90:12 says, so teach us to number our days, that we may present to thee a heart of wisdom. Following Jesus is wise. If we keep our heart and our mind set on him, that's a wise thing, and it helps us realize. Psalms 31:15 tells us that all of our time is in his hands. 2 Corinthians 6:2 tells us that now is the acceptable time if we haven't accepted him. And from our pastor's message last week, Psalm 144:4, man is like a mere breath. His days are like a passing shadow. Mere breath, passing shadow. It's hard for me to believe that I'm 70. It's probably hard for some of you to realize how old you are. I honestly didn't think I'd make it this long. But here I am. And then here you are. You know? So where are we at? Okay. Some of us will hopefully raise the average age. And then some of us won't. You know, it's been such a blessing to sit under Dr. Bunce's teaching, hearing his messages, and also for us men that have been able to take his, what do they call it, preacher boys classes or whatever, you know. It's been such a blessing to be in that and to learn more of the Word and be mentored by a person that loves Jesus Christ that is serving God. Part of the problem, I think, in our churches today is that so many of the people are getting any discipleship. There's no mentoring. There's no discipleship. Most churches don't have Sunday school now. We still try to. Where people can get learning. It's not available. Used to in the homes, men and women would read the Bible to their children. And they would talk about Bible stories. You know, I remember having the little books for my kids to read them at night. You know, I seldom did because I was tired. No, you go do it. I'm tired. Not investing the time where it should have been invested. And parents aren't investing in their children, as you see how the schools are, how our young people are, how teenagers are, how disconnected people are. And the devil threw COVID at us, and that made everything worse. It made it ramp up. In math, we would call that what? Something to the nth power, potential, exponent. Which one did I mess up there, Miss Haynes? You know, so everything is ramping up as the time gets closer. I know at my age now, the days go by faster, the weeks go by faster, the months go by faster than when I was a kid waiting to get my driver's license. I thought it was never going to happen. I thought, oh, I just want to be 21 so I can go party with the other guys. You know, waiting on those dates. Totally wrong priorities in a youth because I hadn't listened to the teaching before then very much. So as we set our priorities and as we do the things we're supposed to be doing, we need to keep our heart and our mind on Jesus. And like I said, I told you how old I was, and none of you said you look older, which, thank you, that was a blessing. Billy Graham said, do you know who you really are? You were made in the image of God. You were made to glorify God. You were made for God, and without God, there's an empty place in your life. That could be filled right now simply by surrendering to Jesus Christ. So my friends, the response is yours. If you haven't accepted Jesus as your Savior, there's no time like the present. Maybe you need to join this fellowship and come and worship with us and rededicate that I'm going to show up and I'm going to learn more about Jesus. I'm going to learn more about God. I'm going to try to learn more about what my purpose is. And if you'd have told me my purpose would be what it is today, 10 years ago, I would have laughed at you. Said, I don't know where you're coming from, but you need to probably go rethink it. Whatever the Holy Spirit is giving you the unction to do, I would encourage you to do it today. Now, we're going to play a video. It's called Living Water, and it's one of my favorite entertainers, Christian entertainers, and it's Ann Wilson. And Karen may remember that I brought back her card from one of the things that how blessed we were, you know, as a people. So listen to the words of this, and then we'll have a short time right after that, okay? So watch this video, please.
This goes out to every outcast, till they just don't quite fit in. Every wrong way, runaway rebel, so ashamed of where you've been. This goes out to every searcher, trying to fill that empty space. Well, your searching days are over now, everything's about to change. Thank you. prize. So when you're tired of all your running, you don't have to run no more. You can leave it all behind you. Just believe and be reborn. Come on down to the living water. Waves of mercy washing over you. No more strangers, only sons and daughters. Come down to the living water and rise up anew. Oh, this is your invitation. Oh, no more lost and alone. Oh, this is your invitation. Hear your Father say it. Welcome home. See that cross upon the steeple. Hear that sweet forgiveness song. Come and join the Jesus people. This is where your heart belongs.
Told the woman at the well that he would give her water that she would thirst no more. So that's our invitation to take Jesus in our heart. So if you'd like to come forward, this is a good time. And if you don't, okay, whatever you decide. So we'll close in prayer. Father God, thank you so much for your goodness and your mercy to each one of us. Thank you that you loved us so much that you sent your Son to die on the cross for us. And Father, we thank you that he's not on the cross anymore. He's not in the grave anymore, but he is coming back for us. And we praise your holy name. Go with each one of us this afternoon and continue to bless these families and this people in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thank you all.